Welcome back, everyone. We will now begin our fourth panel for the conference and first panel for today, and it's an all-women panel. The panel is called Promoting Women's Participation, and it will be chaired by our distinguished Dr. Sharon Siddique. Dr. Sharon Siddique is a visiting professorial fellow at the Lee Kuan Yew Center for Innovative Cities, Singapore, at the Singapore University of Technology and Design, SUTD. She's a development sociologist and is currently working on various aspects of social, cultural, and religious change in Southeast Asia. Welcome, Dr. Siddique, and over to you. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, we have, as usual, a packed schedule here. It's now 10:30, and at 11:50 we are going to be adjourning for lunch. So we have three presentations to get behind us, and then hopefully time for a short question and answer period. So. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce you very briefly to the speakers. On my extreme left is Professor Lilia Labidi, who's currently a visiting research professor at the Middle East Institute here in Singapore. She's an anthropologist and psychologist and has taught at very many various institutions throughout the world, including the University of Tunis, Institute for Advanced Studies at Princeton, and she's also a founder and active member of the Association of Tunisian Women for Research and Development. She was also a politician, or is a politician, being Minister of Women Affairs in the Tunisian Government of National Unity in 2011. I will be very brief in my introductions to all of them and then ask them to make their presentations. Next, to my left, is Noor Laiq, who is the Chief Content Officer for Social Media for the Indian National Congress in Delhi. She has been a Senior Policy Analyst at the International Peace Institute, where she designed and led an Arab youth project. And she is also now author of many books, and she has received her MPhil in Modern Middle Eastern Studies from the University of Oxford. On my immediate left is Professor Samia Botmeh, who is a professor of economics at Birzeit University in Palestine. She completed her PhD in SOAS with a thesis on Palestinian women's labor supply issues. And Samia's areas of interest and publications include gender economics, labor economics, and political economy of development. So I think we are prepared for some extremely interesting insights into our topic of promoting women's participation after the Arab Spring. And so without further ado, I'd like to introduce Samia to make her presentation. Thank you.
Morning, and thank you for the introduction and for inviting us for this interesting conference. As the title of my presentation indicates, it will discuss the economic participation of women. And I give the Palestinian case as an example. It's not really the statements I'm going to be making can be actually generalized to the rest of the region. What's interesting about the Palestinian case is that it's an extreme one. It exposes the issues very clearly. My outline for this presentation, since we have only 20 minutes, so we have to be very organized, I will first introduce what is really paradoxical about women's participation in the labor market. And then I will talk about how our understanding of this participation has led to economic policies that perpetuated the problem of exclusion from the labor market. Then I will talk about, since the sessions are moving towards solutions, I will try to look at how can we differently understand issues of participation and therefore recommend policies that can deal with the issues in a more realistic and more productive way. I will try to also focus, since my issue is really very micro in nature, it's a very micro indicator, how do we abstract from micro issues into macroeconomic policies? Because without establishing these links between the micro indicators and the macroeconomic policies, we will always act in a very sectoral, isolated manner. So what is the issue with participation of Palestinian women, which also applies to the rest of the region? Palestinian women have the lowest participation rate in the world. Nowhere else in the world women take part in the labor market as little as in Palestine. And this is paradoxical because we have the highest educational rates in the region. This is in relation to schooling and in relation to university education. Compared to other women in the region, but also compared to men. So why is then Palestinian women, who are very highly educated, compared to the rest of the region, i.e. women in the rest of the region, and men, take part in a very small scale in the labor market? The participation rate of Palestinian women is around 17%. The average for the world is around 60, for lower middle income countries is around 50%, and the Arab region is 32. Palestinian society is also not the most conservative. Saudi Arabia has higher participation rates for women compared to Palestine. So this is the paradox that I will try to explain and try to navigate through it by first looking at the characteristics of this participation, just very general aggregate statistics. So this is how it looks like, participation rates after 1994, and 1994 is selected as the post-Oslo Accords period. Participation rates have risen. They've risen minimally over this period of time, but they have been experiencing an increasing trend. Unemployment rates for women, the components of participation, are higher than men, nearly double the unemployment rates of men. Over time, men's unemployment rates have been declining while women's have been increasing. There is an extreme horizontal segregation for women in the labor market. And segregation here refers to the concentration of women in very few sectors. Now, this is a phenomenon which is very common across the world. Hardly anywhere in the world, Sweden, the US, Tanzania, you find women in the construction sector or in the transport sector. So this is not very unique. What's very unique about it is that it is extreme. Women are found in services and agriculture predominantly, and not in very large numbers. There is vertical segregation. Vertical segregation refers to the difference in wages, basically. This is real, inflation is taken out. So women's wages are lower than men's, particularly in the private sector. Younger women are excluded from the labor market. Their participation rate is nearly 10%. So they have basically very slight chance to be in the labor market. And this is a very serious problem that is really not comparable to anywhere else. So how do we understand this problem? In a conventional way, how we understand it is by trying to look at issues of determinants of participation. And this is a very typical way of analyzing participation, which has been done by the World Bank, most of the UN agencies, most of universities around the world and academics. So we have participation, and we look at participation in relation to a number of explanatory variables. theory directs us towards what we call individual characteristics, i.e. education, a woman's age, number of her children, the wages of males in her household, and her geographical location, be it, you know, within a rural, urban, and the Palestinian context, we have refugee camps. In addition to that, we look at potential wages. So these are the characteristics, or these are the variables, the factors that would explain women's participation or lack of in the labor market. And it's important to note that with the exception of wages, everything else is supply side. So everything else is related to the characteristics of the woman. How well she did in terms of her education, how many children she had. So it's all about the individual. That's what theory tells us. Now, if we run these equations, and there are a series of equations in the sense of, you know, we go through reduced forms and structural form and, you know, all these econometrics, gymnastics, and we end up with results. And these results tell us that the impact of education in the case of the Palestinian women is positive, i.e. the more education women have, the more likely they are to be in the labor market. Age is also exerts a positive effect on participation. Number of children, the more children that a woman has, the less that she's likely to participate. Male wages, this is very different from many other countries. Male wages exert a positive effect on women's participation. And this has to do with class issues in the sense that usually when male wages are lower, female participation is higher. But in the Palestinian context, it seems that when male wages are higher, women's participation is higher, i.e. Higher earning men marry also women who are working. Geographical location, this says basically that living in a rural area has a likelihood of women participating more in the labor market, and potential wages, of course, when wages are higher, we have, in a way, more likelihood of women working. Now, this model, which is very influential in terms of policy implications, around it has been structured a whole industry of aid and support to women issues. And we are told that by making it even more sophisticated, we will get better answers. So I tried to make it more sophisticated. So I introduced time elements into this model to introduce this element of sophistication. And that actually gives an insight of, confirms my initial results, that education actually is highly important in participation. Now, the policy prescriptions that have been drafted for all women in the Middle East is that, based on this model, women should enhance their education further. Fertility rates should be reduced. That should help women deal with issues of participation. Wage discrimination should be fought. And all of these are, in a way, legitimate, worthy, factors of intervention and policy prescriptions. But there is a problem with all of these policies. It actually does not answer the question of why women aren't in the labor market given their high levels of education. We still have not, going through all these sophisticated models and econometrics gymnastics, we still did not provide an answer, an adequate answer. Participation rates remain low in the Palestinian context and across the Middle East, across the Arab world, despite the fact that educational rates have been rising over the past century and fertility rates have been declining. So why is participation not responsive? So these models do not provide, they provide a valuable insight, but not an adequate one. Also, this model, which is also very influential, is reduces women's experiences to immediate responses to the market. So women look at wages and decide to either enroll in the labor market or not. So it looks at a very, it assumes, you know, the very fluid, flexible labor markets, and individuals choose to be in or out of the economy. And then, in a way, it places the fact that it focuses on the supply side, it focuses on individuals, it places the burden of taking part in the labor market or not on women. So it's women's fault not to be in the labor market. It overlooks also the economic structures. And this is, in a way, what I'm going to focus on for the rest of my presentation. Economic structures that are politically determined are at the heart of women's experiences in the labor market. Then other social factors that are interlinked with economic issues, which are very important in a very, you know, patriarchal setting. So how do we deal then with the issue of economic participation? We really have to venture out of conventional theories into more heterodox economics. And that allows us to look at the trends over time and understand these trends, not just from an economic perspective, but a political, social one. And to look at the demand side of the labor market. Demand side is at the heart of the provision or lack of labor for people to enroll or otherwise in the labor market. And then issues of how patriarchy engages economics and decides upon women's existence in the economic sphere or otherwise. If we look at historical trends, if we go before the period of 1994 within the Palestinian context, we actually see a different scenario. At that time, educational rates were rising significantly and participation rates were declining significantly. In the post, if we go back to the, if we go back to the to this figure, we see that post 1994, women's participation were increasing. In the pre 1994, despite the rise in education, participation was declining. So the issue is not really education. The issue is not age. There is something else that's keeping women out of the labor market. And that has to do with the economic structures. Now, everywhere in the world, women are found in 3 to 4 sectors. Agriculture, manufacturing, and services, newly technology. Now, these three sectors provide women with work anywhere. It's how it is in the US, it's how it is in Singapore, in many places around the world. In the Palestinian context, the fact that over the past century and to a lesser extent in the rest of the Middle East, there has been a continuous erosion of the productive sectors. And we can see that with looking at agriculture and manufacturing contribution to GDP. So over the years, and this trend, if we go back to the 60s, if we go back to the 50s, I actually traced it from 1920. It shows that the erosion of the productive sectors, where usually women would be found, has contributed to the unavailability of work. Basically, women have no place in the labor market, even if all of them get PhD degrees. So even if none of them has any children, there is no place for women in the labor market because the economy does not provide the sectors that employ women. Within the Palestinian context, education has interplayed with the strength of the productive sectors to allow education to exert either a positive or be a neutral factor. So whenever there was an expansion in the productive sectors, or services actually, education was able to play a role. Without that, education was neutral in its effect on women's participation. Patriarchy is very important. It plays a role through allowing women to enter the labor market or not at different points in time. And it has to be assessed in relation to household bargaining power issues. Now, the initial policy implications that we are going by currently in the Middle East is that women should enhance their education. That's the predominant policy implication. What I'm arguing is for us to allow for higher participation for women in the labor market, we should not really be bothering about further education at the moment. We should be bothering about enhancing the productive sectors of the economy. And it's a very different conclusion. That conclusion looks at individuals, looks at their skills, and what I'm arguing for is a demand-side intervention. Now, this is a very micro issue. How do we link it to macroeconomic policy is also very important, because if we deal with this issue as a very sectoral manner, in a very micro manner, it will actually never translate itself into rises in women's participation. Now, in order to enhance the capacity of the productive sectors, we have to intervene with macroeconomic policies. Again, you know, neoliberal policies have been very harmful for the productive sectors in general, and therefore very harmful for women's prospects for participation in the labor market. In order to enhance these sectors, one has to introduce more and more protective policies. In the Palestinian context, we deal with two layers of issues, colonialism and neoliberalism. And the interaction between these two levels is very complex, because we have issues to do with economic policies, but also we have issues stemming from political constraints. The politics, the manner with which we are able or otherwise to manipulate macroeconomic policy, particularly trade restrictions from Israel, we have more than 55% of our GDP is imports from Israel, while our local production, Israel practices economic dumping within the West Bank and to a lesser extent in the Gaza Strip. And that economic dumping means that the productive sectors have been killed off. So in order to prevent this economic dumping, there has to be an intervention on a trade level to protect the Palestinian economy. That means we have to deal with issues like the Palestinian Development Plan, which is a blueprint of, you know, it's a classic document of neoliberalism. It's the pride of the World Bank. And Palestinians, and very much within the region, re-articulate neoliberalism as, you know, the advances of the Quran, as, you know, very, very, in a very positive light. But also the Oslo Accords, which are a very political economic agreements, restrict our capacity to control macroeconomic policy. So in a way, without dealing with these politically determined agreements that have economic repercussions, it is difficult to interfere in the productive sectors, and therefore it is difficult to have to, in a way, achieve any progress in terms of women's participation. So in a way, this link between this small microeconomic indicator and lifting it up to macroeconomic policies and lifting it up to political interventions is, I think, the way forward in dealing with issues of economic stagnation and economic problems in the Arab region. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Samia, for setting an excellent tone for our panel discussion. Could I now call on Noor, please, to give her presentation?
Hello. waiting for the slide. Good morning, and thank you for having me here. I'm going to be talking about young women after the Arab Spring. Women played an active and highly visible role in the Arab uprisings. They were present in huge numbers on the streets and at the barricades in Tunis, Cairo, and Sana'a. They formed part of the vanguard calling for a new kind of politics. They demanded political rights and socioeconomic empowerment. But where do women stand today in the post-uprising landscapes of Tunisia, Egypt, and Yemen? Women, like anybody else, do not, of course, form a homogenous group. And my interviews with them suggest that there's a great difference between the narratives of narratives and activism of young women and the older generation of women's rights activists. We often hear the voices of the older generation, but this talk will be focusing specifically on the younger generation of women. My talk is based on over 120 hours of interviews conducted with youth activists over extended stays in Egypt and Tunisia, as well as interviews with Yemeni activists, including the Nobel Peace Prize winner Tawakkul Karman. As I talk, I'll also be showing you photographs of political graffiti that I took in Cairo. This one, actually, to begin with, is part of the a stencil campaign by graffiti artists against sexual harassment. And this one in particular came up after the famous Blue Bra incident when the military had stripped a woman down to her underwear and beaten her up. So who are the young women activists that I'd been talking to? In terms of age, most of the activists in Tunisia were in their early 20s and in Egypt in their early 30s. However, I define young women not by their age, but rather as a generation who've been through a rite of passage marked by a shared historical moment and a shared consciousness. I met with women activists, including young politicians from Nahda and the Muslim Brotherhood, as well as the various secular parties, from parliamentary watchdogs, education initiatives, media collectives, as well as bloggers. And then, of course, I also met the older generation of women's rights activists. This talk is about their narratives as well as their actions, how they negotiate change within political parties and civil society organizations. What are the ideas they believe in? What are their aspirations and the challenges they face? How can they better mobilize and be better supported in their struggle for political and economic rights? To begin with the current situation, women do not have a greater political voice and are not more politically integrated after the Arab uprisings. In terms of economic opportunity, they continue to be disproportionately affected by unemployment, with joblessness rates often highest amongst young, educated women. Security in the public sphere has become worse in terms of targeted sexual harassment, police brutality, arrest, and detention. I'll start with women in the political sphere. Most young women still view politics as a dirty word, and most prefer civil society activism. However, there are a few who have joined the political system. The young female politicians I interviewed voice their frustration at the entrenched older generation of party elites. One interview explained how the older generation sees politics as a zero-sum game and are not interested in compromise. In Egypt, Tunisia, and Yemen, parties are perceived by the young to function along vertical lines with little of the horizontal decision-making and idea generation that youth had become accustomed to during the days of the uprisings. Egyptian young women are usually not integrated into party structures, with few parties having given any thought to either integrating them into its committees or creating a youth wing or even a women's wing. This has led to the formation of some youth parties, though their fortunes have changed day by day as they face struggles related to financial and structural issues similar to that of any fledgling organization. Most young women in political parties are left to fend for themselves, which for some has its own appeal in the autonomy it allows. In terms of political activism, there is a greater emphasis on the importance of protest politics and less of a focus on building structures, messaging, or positioning themselves within the party. In comparison, in Yemen, both youth and women have a 30% quota on the national dialogue, and Tunisian women are also better integrated into the political system. The first post-Ben-Ali elections were held with a gender parity law for party candidate lists. Young women also have a presence within party structures. Nearly all the political parties I met had engaged with the youth issue, and at times the women's issue. Tunisian youth, I mean, this is because Tunisian youth have actually been more vocal about demanding a seat at the table. As a result, most political parties in Tunisia have some youth representatives on their central committees or have established parallel youth structures. While this structure tends to function along hierarchical lines, it also offers a political ladder to climb up within the system. This translates into political activism in Tunisia, which is quite different from that in Egypt, because political activity tends to then center around party congresses, the development of policy platforms and messaging, and further campaigns for a greater youth voice internally. This slide is just to give you an indication of how youth view politics and why I say it's still a dirty word, because what you see is the hand of the Muslim Brotherhood dropping a young person into the grinder of the military machine, which pretty much sums up the youth view of politics. For young women, the biggest gain of the revolution has been the opening up of space for civil society. This is where they have a huge presence, which ranges from their presence in youth movements with tens of thousands of members to individual activists. Most youth or female-led civil society organizations that I met focused on putting the citizen at the center of the political process. In Egypt, many groups work on raising awareness of political and socioeconomic rights and in challenging the deep state and its practices, and this was particularly initially in the security and media sectors. In Tunisia, in comparison, there's a greater emphasis on playing the role of watchdog and monitoring state institutions, such as the parliament, at the time, the constitution drafting committee, and the election commission. And this slide, actually, the photo on the left is when I went to the Tunisian National Assembly, along with a young woman who was the only person broadcasting from her iPad the deliberations of the assembly every day, and that those are the only official records of the assembly that exist. And this was again a young civil society initiative. And then the photo on the right is, well, it's the youth impression of media, which has been a huge issue, and the Pinocchio, which is quite obvious. Don't need to explain that. In both Egypt and Tunisia, young women have also undertaken development work, though these tended to be Islamist-leaning organizations, which to me was in keeping with the history of civil society activism in the two countries. Young women are heavily invested in the idea of civic duty and engagement. Their activism is based on horizontal organizational structures rather than vertical hierarchies of leadership. In the days leading up to the revolution, youth action was based primarily on this principle. Having successfully used a loose decision-making structure to start a revolution, they now expect to be able to continue to function in the same way and achieve similarly spectacular results. However, nearly all civil society organizations I interviewed face structural and financial constraints, as well as challenges related to strategy and long-term planning. Many groups have been determined to continue with their activism, but disillusionment has already set in. Some activists, as well as their constituents, also feel that now they're merely highlighting the issues as opposed to being able to actually offer and implement solutions, as was the case before the revolution. This picture is self-explanatory. It's a young graffiti artist depicting themselves as the knight in shining armor. I'm going to talk now about primary narratives amongst young women. In Egypt, Tunisia, and Yemen, all the interviews stated that the issues most important to them were actually social justice and freedom. They're keen to move away from old models of thinking and governing. Through the revolutions, they've articulated a new discourse grounded in these aspirations. To young women, this revolution was about regimes and not about gender. One activist in Yemen said, then men and women were all working for the same thing in this revolution, and what we really want is to be able to speak our minds. Like most of the young women I interviewed, Tawakkul Karman has also been reluctant to present herself as a women's rights activist. She stressed that while women's rights are important, I campaign for human rights, and if you talk of human rights, then women's rights are at the forefront because women make up half of society. She doesn't believe that women should campaign for their rights solely for women, that they should campaign to assert all rights in society, and that's what women have done in the young women have done in the Arab Spring. Almost without exception, the young activists I interviewed preferred to be seen as advocates for the broader expansion of political and economic rights rather than specifically for women's rights. Having said that, there has been a tendency to move towards a politics of polarization even amongst young women. In some cases, the polarization has actually been as a result of the women's rights issues with regard to the constitutions in Egypt and Tunisia and their clauses, as well as the issue of CEDAW. But for many, polarization has led them not to focus on women's issues, but rather to actually split their activism. Here, there was a difference between Egypt and Tunisia. In Tunisia, there is an identity crisis where the Islamists and secularists that I interviewed each thought that the other was from Mars. There was one said that the general feeling was, where the hell did this other person come from? I met both Salafi women as well as, of course, Nehda and then secular women. And most of them tended to want the same rights, even though their political leanings were different. In Egypt, I didn't find anyone questioning where the Brotherhood or Salafis came from, but it was a more, I would argue, politicized polarization. So young women that I met weren't against political Islam, as actually the Salafi Hizbul Nur's coming second in the first election would suggest, but it was much more a politics of being against the Brotherhood, which was vilified actually both by Islamist-leaning women as well as secular women. And that wasn't necessarily because of political Islam, but it was more because they saw the Muslim Brotherhood as being sort of what they call the other side of the coin of the Mubarak regime. So they didn't actually see much difference between the two. This actually is a photo I took of a wall in Cairo, and it just again is sort of, in terms of the polarization, it gives an indication of people's fears with the three women, I mean, going from no headscarf, to a niqab. However, young women are different from the older generation in that they also, whilst they might be polarized, they also have a parallel narrative that places great emphasis on promoting the idea of equal citizenship. To quote an interviewee, they believe that a Pandora's box has been opened, but that the only solution is to work through all the issues created by 60 years of authoritarian rule. Thus, while polarized, many youth interviewed argue that there's no option but now to work through the crisis. They emphasize the need for dialogue to overcome legacies of the past and to promote tolerance. The issue of polarization in politics is where the generation gap between the younger and older generation of women activists is probably at its most acute. This was actually a photo at a women's rights demonstration that I went to in Egypt, and there were lots more older women present than there were younger women at it. The gap between young and old, I think, is also partly because the older generation of women's activists, in Egypt in particular, are seen as having been compromised for their closeness to the old regime, although this would also probably stand for Tunisia and Yemen. In Egypt in particular, some of the more ardent secular activists in the older generation of women are seen as being compromised because of their campaign for women's rights now over broader political rights. And especially in the last year, their stance against rights for Islamist-leaning women. And this has been played out with the Muslim Brotherhood versus the secularists in Egypt. In contrast, young women have repeatedly situated women's rights within the broader discourse on equality and democratic citizenship for all. However, there are two areas where both the aspirations of both younger and older women's activists meet. These are the economy and security. The economy, in many ways, is the elephant in the room. The old model of functioning was, of course, to exchange political rights for economic entitlements. This is what both the Brotherhood did and the military is still trying to do with responding to demands of the most important groups. So they raise the salaries of university teachers or civil servants, etc. But the state, of course, is bankrupt, so they're not going to be able to keep this up. In Cairo itself, I witnessed many strikes, the microbus driver's strike, the doctor's union, the gas workers, teachers, and students, all striking, According to an Egyptian think tank, in Egypt alone last year there were 7,000 protests, and in Tunisia 3,000, most of them related to socioeconomic issues. Women, especially young educated women, face the highest unemployment rates of all. Many young women I interviewed had ideas on how this could be fixed. The primary answer amongst them was aiding women's economic empowerment, rested in education for all, and specifically for boys as well, to provide a sense of breaking down gender stereotypes. So whilst there were suggestions to raise literacy and making education fit for employment, there was also a lot of concern that curricula should be revised to break down stereotypes and encourage both young boys and girls to think of women as leaders. Other suggestions were focused on governments to more actively engage in bolstering private sector jobs for women through tax relief for women-only businesses, small women-only businesses, providing facilities for small businesses, partnering between private and the private sector and civil society, and providing access to finance for women, which can be particularly difficult, although this also applies to youth in general. Security has been a huge issue for both young and older women as they face increasing sexual harassment, often targeted, as well as arrests, detentions, and police brutality. This is, the first picture is the blue bra incident I referred to earlier when I was talking about the campaign against it. However, here women across the board were keen for more awareness campaigns under the slogan of threat of violence against women. They stressed the need for governments to create strategies to combat violence against women, to ensure that legislation is consistent in order to secure women's safety, and to have more women in the police force and in the judiciary. So what are the implications of all of this? I'm not suggesting that it's all going to be boys with anarchist flags and ballerinas, but where do we go from here? Both youth and women, and of course young women, have been marginalized after the uprisings, but they've also expanded the political and civic space and have given depth to the meaning of citizen-led movements. They have a broad legitimacy grounded in a politics that exists beyond the structures of the state. However, the most important impact at the moment is neither political nor civic, but it's about changing the debate, especially around the concept of equal citizenship. At the same time, they risk becoming divided by the transition process itself as it pulls them in different directions. In the early days of the transition, these ideas for change relating to political and socioeconomic justice bore a laser-like sharpness, in part because young activists were able to present a united front. Now, there is more of a tendency to fight for single issues, as opposed to linking them to a wider political platform. This has led many young women to resume a pre-2011 model of activism, where they've retreated into their own silos from which they can only fight disjointed campaigns. Such a move risks reinforcing the old mechanism of functioning, where the state would exchange specific entitlements for broader political rights. Ironically, it also might mean that young women might start focusing on women's specific issues as a result. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that presentation. I'd like to now call on our third, last, but certainly not least speaker to give her presentation. Lilia, please.
Assalamu alaikum. My question is, I have to do this also. Is this correct? No. Voilà. My title is How After the Arab Spring Can Rural Tunisian Women Overcome a Development Model That Has Doubly Jeopardized Their Rights in Tunisia? And I will try to answer only about what's happened in 2011, which it will be like a testimony of my part. What is, we should also know a little bit about the actual atmospheres. Since then, two developments, essentially, at least. New figures shows women twice as likely as men to be unemployed, inequality across sex and between region and Tunisia, and how elected people in October 2011 were really badly received recently when they went to visit the region and to present the result of what is the new constitution. as a result, what we can conclude is that youth continue to be politically involved and they express their loss of confidence in political parties and in state institutions. What I would like also to say is that the call for dignity and for jobs continue today and constitute main demands voiced by the youth, and the cases of self-immolation which began in reality with women since the 1990s and with Mohamed Bouazizi in December 2010 draw public attention until today. Self-immolation continues to be one of the forms of expression of despair among the youth. What I will be discussing is I will be reporting, some cases. I will be reporting the experiences and what I learned from what I saw in 2011 about two regions, one in the northwest and one in the southwest, and the two of these groups are women making dolls, and how finally la arusa, from the construction of identity, I will discuss how these, from the construction to identity to collective memory, and how the limits of the legal and economic rights of this group of women, and what role for the state during a democratic transition. I choose to concentrate on rural women. The characteristic of these women that is that they earn their living from their own work, craft production, and they are trained on the job. They learned it as they work. They never went to school or to institute to do this. This group of women revealed the policies toward rural women that were followed by the various governments under Bourguiba and Ben Ali, and they were never contacted by national organizations as UNFG and UGCA, which is the patronat, and my reading is based only on my observations. I would like to present here is how the dolls made by these women refer to models that play an important psychological role, how these dolls have come to represent the social body and its discontinuity that are provoked by dichotomies, and during the democratic transition, how the Ministry of Women's Affairs put in place strategies called Women, the Culture of Citizenship and Democracy, and Economic Solidarity. Here I would like, please, if it is possible, to show you how these the case of these women in rural area until today are used as a reservoir of manoeuvre, and how these films is discussing the case of girls becoming maid in the big cities. Can you? Yes. It's only 1 minute to show you a little bit. And this is another girl who grew up in another family in the city. And this man who was also recruited as these girls when he was young, and now today he is the one who is recruiting these girls for families in the bourgeoisie. And what is important about this film is that these girls are doing the dolls exactly as the women that we are presenting here. This film was very badly received in 2002, as is today. Women who are wearing the hijab are very badly received by the elite and by the intellectuals.
اسمك شوية عربي وزمني. تي تولي تبدي.
She is telling her that she will change her name.
كنا بنتي الأخرى.
Because her name is not enough fancy. Thank you very much. Now, El Arusa from the when I was in Tozer, I noticed that the tourists were not interested at all by buying this kind of dolls and in Sejna, and also when women were having a chance to sell their products, they were really very poorly and low prices, etc. Alors, what is interesting is that Clifford Geertz noticed that in Indonesia, women explain the women's attraction to entrepreneurship and show how these women don't intend to expand their project. And this observation is exactly what also we saw in Tunisia. The women, they didn't look to expand their capital. Only what they wanted is to have enough money to deal for the need for their families. And unfortunately, also, or their daughter do not want to carry on the occupation later. And these dolls are very badly sold by the merchant, and they are for low prices in Tunisia, where they are very highly priced elsewhere in Europe. And since they are not very well sold, they are more, we found that we have more anthropologists, filmmakers, and artists who are more and more interested by these products. Alors, we looked at how we have a painter who is very well known, Khayeshi, who did several work about, some works about children, and one of them is about two girls playing with the dolls and showing exactly what, how they have, and finally, the adult is showing exactly how they have to behave with this kind of things. Alors, here we are approximately in the presence of all what was written in the literature of in psychology. At the anthropological and psychoanalytic reading can suggest insight into the role and function of doll. And this was found also by a group of anthropologists in Zimbabwe, and how fertility dolls accompany young girls from a very early age until the birth of their first child, confirming the need girls have for this object to develop their femininity. Also, in Tunisia, we found that until the 80s, women, the brides bring into their new married household a doll that they will put on the bed until the birth of the first child, when it will be put on the top of the closet, as though the new mother has now gone beyond the fetishization. Donc, the passage from the artisanal, we have also to look at the passage from the artisanal production to the industrial production. I apologize. Several Islamic legal schools, like enabled people to produce this kind of toys. And what happened is that Fulla was produced in China by a Syrian, and it had a lot of success and supplanted the Barbie dolls in the Arab world, and millions of these objects have been sold. In Egypt, the local dolls was named Layla, and in Iran, Fatima. And several of the Western media reacted strongly to the welcome given to Fulla in the region, and the new dynamic of this market pushed the manufacturer of Barbie to re-examine its sales strategy in the Arab Muslim world. The passage from the artisanal production to the industrial production of dolls, like children literature, constitute cultural and commercial space, and the Tunisian market is dominated by imported dolls produced in the West and in recent years in China, and the full doll was withdrawn from sale by the government because of the hijab, as Saudi Arabia did not order the Paul and Emma in 2005 for that clearly differentiated male and female. The passage from the parents were hesitating, and what we saw is also that the parents were hesitating to buy Fulla for their daughters, And probably it was because of the law number 108 of 1981 outlaws the headscarf in public institution, a law that was extended in 1985 to include schools also. And the rejection of Fulla because of the hijab by the government before 2011 and of the women wearing the hijab by the elite after October 2011 revealed the dysfunction of successive government that produced a form of unequal development. Various Tunisian government, in fact, marginalized the rural women like those from Tozer and Sejnan, leaving them in the hands of a governmental organization, the UNFT, which had jeopardized the legal and economic right of these women. How? Legal limits, for examples. Legal limits, they don't know, what we discovered is that they don't know anything about their own right, where in the country where it's the champion of the right of women, and women are used for state purposes, and for example, to have more women to vote for the government, for the regime. And at the economic level, we have in 1980s, the wealthiest 20% of the Tunisian controlled 50% of national economy, and I suppose that you know, for example, in Tunisia, we have 11 million of population, and we have 70 families who are billionaires, where in Morocco, it's a larger country, three times larger, and they have much less than in Tunisia. Donc we can see the disproportion of the what's happening. Alors, quickly, I wanted to show you the number of needy families in 2002 by area. And we have another map for the unemployment in 2004, and we can see how it is, the number is very large. And if we look at the region, we can see how the southwest, the northwest, the southeast, etc., are the region where we have the larger number of women unemployed and which are considered as the rural area. And if we compare the number of women heads of household in rural area in the different countries between 1970s and 1990s, we can see that in Tunisia it has the largest number. Alors, what could be the role of state during a democratic transition? To respond to the question of how after the Arab Spring rural Tunisian women can overcome a development model that has doubly jeopardized their rights, I will report here quickly about brief experiences that may teach us something. First, we asked for parity. The ministry developed a policy based on parity, and what later the high instance for the realization of the objective of the revolution called for a vote on the parity law. The ministry also lifted its reservation on the convention for elimination of all form of discrimination against women, but it was sent to the UN only in April 2014. Also, a large section was consecrated to research. The ministry looked at and revisited all the framework of all legal limits of women and initiated a critical studies about the new family, the divorce, the abandoned children and single mothers, etc., showing the impact of tradition and economic constraint on this new social group. What are the actions that were taken? Two programs were put in place: women, the culture of citizenship and democracy, and economy of solidarity. We put also a program of training developed by, here in this case, is developed specially by a specialist who had deep experiences in the area, and the ministry put in place the collaboration with academic institutions, and the training was organized as an experiment between academic institution and women from rural area, providing solution for other ministries who are in charge of this question. The women of this region were awarded a grant of 1,000 dinars, which is equivalent about $800 each, to advance their project, and were followed by the team that was working on publication and communication and coordination between regional and other offices of other ministries. As a result, these groups participated in the annual fair, artisan fair, in March 2012, and since then they participated every year, which is, we can consider as a little success for these women. Now, this process enabled women, what we can learn, this process enabled women artisans to surmount their negative self-image. This project encouraged and a change in views about rural women living in an environment inherited from the colonial area, giving them visibility. The dolls that they made recreated a tie between the cultural patrimony and construction, constructing themselves as independent and at the same time as a part of a social body. And this process enabled women artisans to benefit from the great added value due to the scientific and technical contribution of the training personnel. And the Minister of Women Affairs reiterated the Khaldunian principle of giving people the opportunity to learn alongside the master of the craft, and to develop a sense of observation. The concept of continuity of double jeopardization applied very well to the UNFG was a function doubly jeopardized the legal and economic rights of women in rural area. The allocation of task with the state in charge of educating urban women and the UNFG in charge of educating women in rural region created a two-tiered system leading to the marginalization of rural women. This process enabled the civil society and independent women to demand the dissolution of the UNFG after the January 2011, because they saw how this organization double jeopardized the rights of women, rural women. And the UNFG was the only organization allowed to have contact with women in the country. All independent organizations were dissolved and their member convicted by the state if they contacted the general population. The Ministry of Women Affairs staff from February to December, how it works, the question is how it works, why it works suddenly. It's in their role as a member of the transitional government, showed a commitment, conscious as they were, of the need to repair social injustice, and that it was not a cosmetic change as it was in the discourse in the past. The aim was to move beyond a strategy of survival toward formal employment via a moral contract where state and citizenship were tied to each other, while under the previous regime, the state was completely absent from the rural world and hardly existed for these women at all. The UNFG president serving the interest of the regime was awarded by the Ministry of Women Affairs via a presidential decree, a secret presidential decree that was not public and that gave her the same rights as a Secretary of State with all that position privilege, which it was not at all known by the population. Since the revolution, the number of associations in general has risen. The number, it's unbelievable. And the number of women associations grow in 1 year as much as during 2 decades. And I hope that we will not be reproducing the same thing as what's happened in the past. It's important that we have a civil society, that it is very active and important, but the role of the state should be strong and there. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I wish only that I could petition to have 20 hours rather than 20 minutes, because I think this panel has presented so many incredibly interesting discussion points. And I'm reminded of two things. One, that I think we've illustrated very well here. Professor Samir Amin's comment that we are at a crossroads. This is the crossroads. And I think I would also like to thank again Noor for her wonderful treat of giving us a flavor of the graffiti artists of the Middle East, which are all geniuses as far as I'm concerned. So I'd like to open up the floor to questions. We have until 11:50 to try to cover at least a few points. So would anyone like to go first? Yes. Did I see a hand back there? No? Anyone? Yes.
Oh, go ahead.
Sorry.
This is a question for Samia. You presented data that showed that the service sector was where most of the Palestinian women were employed. But in your recommendations, you were speaking when you talked about changing the economic structure and enhancing the productive sectors of agriculture and manufacturing. I was wondering where does the service sector figure in your analysis? It seemed to me that it was missing. Thank you.
True, actually, the service sector where, and this applies to the Arab world in general, it's where women are. Women are in education, in nursing, in healthcare in general. And this sector is oversaturated. That's the problem with it. It cannot, first of all, it's not highly productive in terms of returns, and it cannot generate further employment. So where do we look for? We look towards the productive sectors for the future to provide further employment for women. And that's why it's important to work on these sectors that have been undermined through neoliberal policies. Neoliberal policies have basically, within the Palestinian context, combined with colonialism, killed off the sector. These two sectors, as in agriculture and manufacturing at the moment, between them, they contribute something like 20% to GDP. And without that, without actually expanding these sectors across the Arab world, women's participation should not be expected to rise. At the moment, there is a huge amount of work being done, and based on it, policy interventions to do with transition of young people from education into the labor market. And I think this is also problematic because we are exactly in the same circle. How do we equip people better to enter the labor market? Now, if the labor market that's available is the services sector, does that mean all women have to be training for schooling and healthcare? And what does that imply? It implies high competition amongst these women, and it implies that basically further and further women are going to be marginalized. Education is important, but also women without education should have a chance to be in the labor market. And these are excluded, totally excluded, and they represent a large percentage of women in the Arab world. So unless we actually deal with the constraints on the productive sectors that have to do mainly with neoliberalism, i.e. opening up to the rest of the world without any protection for certain industries, unless we deal with that, then women's participation in the labor market will remain to be very low, no matter how much we understand or work on transition from education to the labor market, how much we actually keep on enhancing women's education.
Well, is it working yet? Masoud Karshenas from Source University of London. I have two questions. One, I address it to all the panel, is the question of course, women's issues are very important in the Middle East, but in recent events, we observed that, for example, in the case of Egypt, women themselves were the most sort of the biggest supporters of Muslim Brotherhoods in Egypt. Now, what is it the difference between Tunisia and, let's say, Egypt that makes Tunisian women's movement more progressive? And what strategies do you think one can adopt in countries like Egypt to bring women more into supporting pro-women policies? The second question I have is about female participation and Samia's issues with neoliberalism. Now, I don't, you know, we have to, of course, this afternoon there is a session about neoliberalism. Hopefully we open up that issue to see what it means. But if you mean by neoliberalism opening up to world capitalist market, I think that is probably has a lot of positive things for women. It opens the economy to competition, which means that the businessmen are less able to discriminate amongst different types of labor, which is good for women. You know, capitalism, we know it opens up these archaic societies with their old social norms, etc., position of women, and therefore brings, forces women to the labor market and to the economy. So, again, this is the question of what we mean by neoliberal policies. If it means opening up more to competition, maybe that's not so bad for women. But thanks.
I think that question is directed to Lilia.
We had the experiences with the socialism, and it was rejected. We can speak a little bit about it because it's interesting to go back and to look how, who were the forces, who were against, and what's happened, etc. And in fact, since 1971, we were until 2011 in the liberal system, and we saw what it produced also. There is a cartoon that I could reproduce here, which is really very interesting, and what we see is how in fact, the old country where was Tunisia, but in fact, there is only a region from Tunis, Hammamet, Sousse, who were monasteries, who was the rich region of the country where everything is there, institution of education, of employment, etc., etc., and where in the all other part of Tunisia was abandoned, and they were in fact there to die for this small group. Donc, the question is, I think what we have to do, it's why this conference, it's really very interesting one, is to think about it, what are the perspective for the future, how we think, how what should be done. What we can see actually in Tunisia is that the union of the worker are very strongly asking for several demands, probably contributing a little bit on the difficulties that we are having, but it's probably also what the country need. I don't say that it is the best thing, but probably is the what probably the country need to re-examine what was the policies that were taken by the states all this time. And also what we can see, what is interesting, I think also, and I finish, what is interesting is also the coalition, it's a strange coalition, in fact, it's between the leftist people with the union, with the patrona, the Ruchika, and this also, it's strange, and how, what will result from it, we don't know yet, but it's a little bit also a strange moment.
Well, just to say that I think that the definition of progressive is probably still up for grabs, because in Egypt and Tunisia, the women, young women who supported the Muslim Brotherhood or neither, I mean, would see themselves as progressive because they believe in the expansion of political rights. And some of them, of course, did also believe in women's rights, although some I interviewed were against the signing of some of the conventions like CEDAW. But on the other hand, I'd say that I found amongst the older generation of women, one could question their progressiveness, even though they might be secular, because they didn't believe in political rights for all. So it was only political rights as long as they conformed with their own opinions.
Yeah, just quickly on the issue of neoliberalism, I partly mean issues of trade. Opening up to the rest of the world, the experience of Arab countries has been basically to substitute local production for imports. And that killed off the productive sectors within the Palestinian context more than others. But that also is the case in Egypt, in Jordan, in Lebanon, and so on. Now, killing off the productive sectors without any protection meant that those who are normally employed in these sectors are basically having no place in the economy. Since it is women that usually are employed in these sectors, women ended up outside the economic sphere. Now, in other parts of the world, Latin America, Southeast Asia, the forms of capitalism has enhanced the productive sectors. That is not the case in relation to the Middle East. And as long as we do not deal with that issue, it is really problematic to keep on dwelling on Islam and culture as preventing women from participation in the labor market, because if it is these issues, then why are women out there seeking education? If it is a matter of being present in the public space. So in a way, dealing with these macroeconomic issues to enhance these sectors will be the answer for the Middle East.
Thank you. Another question? Sorry. Yeah, please.
Thank you. Fadl Kaboub from Denison University. Thank you for a great panel. I have a question for Samia's presentation. I agree with you that the decline in industries and manufacturing in Palestine has contributed to the low labor force participation for women. But to what extent is there some empirical evidence to quantify or take into account the physical movement, both for men and women, but in particular for women? To what extent does that contribute to the low labor force participation? I'm talking specifically about checkpoints and being able to move from one location to the other to go to a job site. I also have a quick question to Professor Labidi. The program that you described in Tunisia, starting in 2011-2012, I truly believe that this is the kind of programs that not only sheds light on professions that have been marginalized in the past, participants, women in particular, have been marginalized in the past, but what's interesting to me is to what extent does that not only increase participation in the economic system, but eventually into civic engagement and civic participation. If you could comment on any evidence or any hope for actually doing research and following up on that initial project to see to what extent that contributed to further civic engagement. Thank you.
Would you like to go first with the first question?
Yeah, certainly movement restrictions in terms of checkpoints, in terms of closures and so on have an impact on women's capacity to move freely. The uncertainty facing people moving in general becomes more of an issue for women in the sense that one does not really know how long it takes to get from point A to point B. It might be normally an hour, but actually it could take you 13 hours if a soldier happens to be in a bad mood at a checkpoint. So that certainly affects women's capacity to move freely and therefore to work. But in perspective, compared to earlier periods when there weren't movement restrictions, the impact is not that great. It is really, and if you look at it in terms of women moving for other purposes, women's movement has been affected, but not greatly. When people need to move, they move when they have a purpose. And therefore, it is an issue, but it doesn't seem to be of, to carry such a strong weight.
Thank you for your question. It's really interesting, but you know what I saw in 2011, and it was only experience of 2011, is that, in fact, people were like vide. They didn't have any forces, any strength. They didn't believe in anything during all these years. And when we were trying, because civil society is very active in the capital and in the big cities, but if you go in rural area, you don't have anything. And then you meet a lot of difficulties, because when we try to create it, to push women to create an NGO, etc., we find them ourselves involved in something like corruption, because the village are all composed by the same member of the family. And when we try to give them loans, etc., to help them, the first thing they wanted to do is to share this money among themselves, where we were telling them, no, this is not the law. And donc, there are a lot of difficulties. In cities, it's true, the number of associations grow up immensely, but it's not sure that even these NGOs who were created are able to conduct the work that they dream to do or they wanted to do. Donc, I think in these cases, the role of the state, it's really very important. And I think also what we need, and it's not done, it's that these NGOs also need to be helped before, but also to be evaluated and to be controlled, because it's really very important. Because if you promote an NGO that at the end it's taking all what you are doing for themselves and not sharing what it should be among themselves, this it became to be a problem. What I found it also is, it's not that I found it, it's what the woman said, is that the UNFT, for example, in rural area, were having centers, etc., but these centers were mostly closed. They were not opened every day. They are, donc there is no relationship really with the group in this region. And the girls were asking questions that are really modern, not at all from the past. They were asking for computer, they were asking for internet, for how we can learn, how we can do, which was not provided at all by this kind of center that was dedicated to these women. The problem is, we saw also these women who were dealing with these girls, but the teacher also, the women who were in charge of these centers, were not also prepared to deal with this question. Donc there are a lot of things that must be done. For me, I think the Arab Spring, I know it's sad for a lot of people, we have dead people, etc., but I think really it's great thing because it obliges us to think about what we are doing, how we are doing it, why we are doing it. And it's, you know, it's true that now it's 3 years ago, but it's nothing if you count. If 3 years is probably too much for me, but if you look at the community and the life of the community, it's nothing. Donc what we need is really to stop and to think about to close the door, because what's happened in Tunisia is that we were invited by the all experts from all the world coming to teach us what we should do, how we can consolidate democracy, etc., etc. It's true, it's important, but probably we should close a little bit the door and think by ourselves what we are doing, and in the same time, which is, if it is good to receive people, it's also very good to go to visit other people and to see what is done, because it's not only a question of learning from conference what it could be said. Donc, and I think that something that has happened with the Arab Spring that we didn't see it enough before is that the women who were educated, who were never asking for a job, after the Arab Spring, the number exploded. And why? Because women came to ask for a job. Donc the Arab Spring has something very important for women also, because they became, they felt that they are a member of the society, and it was the right also to ask for something. It wasn't a present that state is giving or allowing or something like this, but it became something that they were asking for. I can speak a lot, but I should stop because...
Thank you. In fact, I think that's a perfect place of complexity, pathos, paradox, for us to end this session. And I want to thank again the three panelists for such intriguing and excellent intellectual presentations. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much to the panelists and the chairperson. We are now going to have lunch in the dining hall. It'll be a very chop-chop affair because we'll have to be back here by 12:30. So thank you.